Okay, good morning dear students, welcome for the physics class. So today we are going to discuss the next part of the nuclei chapter, that is multiplication factor. So multiplication factor means it is the ratio of the number of neutrons in the daughter nuclei to the number of neutrons in the parent nuclei. Okay, so here when the nuclear reactions were taking place, there the neutrons in the daughter nuclei and the neutrons in the parent nuclei may be same or may not be same. Okay, so here, so the ratio of it is the ratio of number of neutrons in daughter nuclei to the number of neutrons in parent nucleus. Okay, so that is the definition of multiplication factor. Okay, where we are using this multiplication factor? In order to define the critical mass, in order to define the critical size. Okay, so what it means? So first I consider the critical size. What do you mean by the critical size? Critical size means it is the size of the fissionable material for which the multiplication factor is 1. For which the multiplication factor is 1. Okay. So, here, fissionable material means which is act as a fuel for the nuclear fission. That we have discussed in the previous class. Okay. So, here, critical size means it is the size of that fissionable material for which the multiplication factor is 1. That means here the number of neutrons in the daughter nuclei should be equal to the number of neutrons in the parent. Then we can get the multiplication factor as of 1. Okay. Numerator and denominator should be same, then only we can get the 1. Okay. If you want to get the multiplication factor as of 1, then the daughter nuclei and the parent nucleus should have the same number of neutrons. Then only we can get the multiplication factor 1, and such material size is called as fissionable material size is called as critical size. Okay, it is size of the fissionable material for which multiplication factor is 1. For which multiplication factor is 1. Next comes critical size. So what do you mean by critical size? Similarly, it is the size of the fissionable material for which the multiplication factor is 1. Okay? Okay. Size of the fissionable material for which multiplication factor is 1. For which multiplication factor is 1. Okay. Next, we are having the we're having the
the nuclear fusion, or you can also call it as a thermonuclear reaction. Okay.
Nuclear fusion. So here the nuclear fusion is also called as thermonuclear reaction. Is also called as thermonuclear reaction. Thermonuclear fusion reaction. Okay. So what do you mean by the nuclear fusion reaction? So it is the process of combining the two lighter nuclei in order to get the heavy nucleus with the release of enormous energy. It's called as nuclear fusion reaction. Okay. So here, this the process of combining two lighter nuclei to form a single nucleus. A single nucleus with a release of huge energy. This process is called as nuclear fusion. How it happens? Just consider the two deuterium nuclei, means the two hydrogen isotopes. Two H2 isotopes. When we combine those two isotopes, those two deuteriums, we are going to get the helium nucleus with a release of almost 24 mega electron volt of energy. Okay. So that is it. When we combine the two deuterium nuclei, that is one H2 plus one H2, what we are going to get? Two HE4 along with that, we are going to get 24 mega electron volts of energy. Is it clear? 24 mega electron volt of energy. In this process, how we have got this 24 mega electron volt of energy? Because we have got here the mass defect. Here, we are getting the mass defect of 0.0258 AMU. Okay, so the mass defect of 0.0258 AMU is equivalent to 24 mega electron volt of energy. Okay. So here we are going to find the mass defect of 0.02568 AMU, and that mass defect has been converted into energy, so that is the equivalent of 24 mega electron volt. Okay. Then what do you mean by the mass defect? Mass defect means it is the difference between the mass of the constituents of the nucleus and the mass of the nucleus. So here, it is the difference between mass of the constituents of the nucleus and the mass of the nucleus. What do you mean by the constituents of the nucleus? The constituents of the nucleus means that is proton and neutron. So here, the difference in the masses of protons of neutron and the mass of the nucleus is called as mass defect. Okay. So mass defect means it is difference in mass of constituents of nucleus and mass of nucleus. Okay, and here the mass effect will be indicated by delta m. Mass effect will be indicated by delta m. Okay, so here in the form of expression we have to write the mass effect. Then the mass of the constituents of the nucleus means the mass of protons, mass of all the protons and the mass of all the neutrons together, the mass of the constituents of the nucleus. So that is mass of one proton into the number of protons. The number of protons means Z. And plus mass of one neutron and the number of neutrons. Number of neutrons is A minus Z. So this combined we get the mass of the constituents of the nucleus. And minus mass of the nuclear atomic capital. Okay? So here M T means the number of protons and Z means the number of protons. A minus Z means the number of neutrons, Z means the mass of neutron, one neutron mass of, okay? Minus capital M means it is the mass of the nucleus. Okay? Just take a screenshot and just write it down. Okay, next, why the nuclear fusion reaction is called as a thermonuclear reaction? Why it is called so? So, nuclear fusion reaction takes place only under the high temperature. Nuclear fusion reaction takes place under the high temperature. So, that's why we can also call it as the thermonuclear reaction or thermonuclear fusion reaction. Okay. So here the nuclear fusion reaction takes place under high temperature. Under high temperature takes place only under high temperature. Therefore, it is called as thermonuclear reaction. Why is this take place only under the high temperature? Because in order to achieve the fusion between two lighter nuclei, we need high temperature. Why? Because of electrostatic repulsive force. Remember, because of electrostatic force of repulsion between the nucleons, it is not so easy to achieve the fusion. Okay, so the fusion reaction takes place only when the two nuclei approaching with a kinetic energy of 0.1 mega electron volt or more. Okay? So here nuclear fusion of two nuclei is achieved when they were approaching each other with 0.1 mega electron volt or more kinetic energy. Okay? If they were moving with this much of kinetic energy, then only the fusion can achieve. Right? But this energy, kinetic energy,
will be getting by the temperature of the order of 10 to the power 6 Kelvin. Okay? So the nucleus are going to get 0.1 mega electron volt or more kinetic energy under the temperature of the order of 10 to the power 6 Kelvin only. This is a very huge temperature, very high temperature. So under this temperature only, the fusion can be achieved, can be takes place. So that's why the name of this experiment also taken as the thermonuclear reaction. The thermonuclear reaction. Okay. So now we study the difference between nuclear fission and nuclear fusion. Okay. So first one, write a nuclear fission. And next, nuclear fusion. Okay. So first difference is their definition itself. Their definition itself. So how can we define the nuclear fission? The splitting of copper, heavy nuclear into two daughter nuclei of comparable masses with the release of high energy. Okay? So divide that. It is process of splitting off heavy nuclear into two daughter nuclei of comparable masses. Okay, but here it is the process of combining two lighter nuclei. Process of combining two lighter nuclei to form a single nucleus. The process of combining two lighter nuclei to form single nucleus. Here the two nuclei could be combined to get a single nucleus. Here the single nucleus splits into two daughter nuclei. Okay. And here, so already we have seen in the nuclear fission reaction, what is the energy release? That will be 200 mega electron volt. What is the energy release in the fusion? That is 24 mega electron volt. So energy release per fission is more as compared to fusion. Energy release per fission. Energy release for fusion is more, but here energy released for fusion is less. Energy released per nucleon is less. Here energy released per nucleon is mode. Is mode. How? So here in a fission reaction, in a parent nucleus, we are having the 236 when we consider the uranium 236 for as a fissionable material. Okay? 235, uranium 235 after absorbing a neutron, it will become uranium 236. So how many neutrons we are having? How many nucleons? We are having there 236 nucleons. And what is the energy released there? 200 mega electron volt energy have been released from the 236 nucleons. Okay? From 236 nucleons, we are going to get 200 mega electron volt energy. Then what is the energy released per single nucleon? Then 200 divided by 236. Okay? So 200 for 236. Then what is for 1? So that is 200 divided by 236. So whatever answer we are getting, that is for energy per single nucleon. And here, in the case of fusion, total we are having 4 nucleons. From the 4 nucleons, we are getting 24 mega electron volt. So what is the energy released for 1? That is 24 divided by 4. That is energy released for a single nucleon. So here, in fusion, the energy per single nucleon is more as compared to the energy released per nucleon in the fission. Okay, in the fission, it is less, in fusion, it is more. And here, the fourth one, it takes place at low temperature. Okay, fission takes place at low temperature. But here it has take place at a high temperature. Takes place at a high temperature. Okay? And it forms the principle of atom bond. It forms the principle of atom bond. Atom bond. Okay? Now atom bond, the fission principle, nuclear fission principle is going to use. And it forms the principle of hydrogen bond. It forms the principle of hydrogen. Okay, right. Next, we are having the stellar energy. What do you mean by the stellar energy? What do you mean by the stellar energy? Stellar energy means it is energy released by the sun or by the star. Okay?
It is energy released by the sun or star. It's called a stellar energy. And what is the source for the stellar energy? Source for the stellar energy is nothing but the fusion reaction, nuclear fusion reaction, thermonuclear reaction, which is taking place inside the star, which is taking place inside the sun. And that is responsible for the stellar energy. It means the energy which is liberated from the sun, which is liberated from the star. Okay? Which is only because of
the nuclear fusion reaction which are going to take place interior of the sun or in the interior part of the star. Okay, right. And how can we say that the nuclear fusion reaction only will be responsible for the stellar energy? Because we have observed some of the facts. So based on that fact, we can conclude that the nuclear fusion reaction is only the source of the stellar energy. Okay. And what are those facts? Okay. We will consider sun only. We consider the sun only. So look here. In a nuclear fusion reaction, we have only the hydrogen isotopes and the helium, deuterium and helium. Okay. So in the nuclear fusion reaction, only we have the role of deuterium and helium. So inside the star, most part is of hydrogen and helium. The first observation. So inside the sun, we have the most part of the sun will be helium and hydrogen. Hydrogen and helium. Okay. And next one, the temperature inside the sun. The temperature inside the sun is almost of about 10 degrees to 7 Kelvin. Such a high temperature. In that high temperature, we can achieve the fusion reaction. The fusion reaction needs that much temperature. Okay. And the third fact is the enormous energy liberated outside the sun. So that is 3.8 into 10 to the power 26 joules per second. Okay. 3.8 into 10 to the power 26 joules per second. This is the high energy. This much amount of energy will be liberated out by the sun. Will be given out by the sun. Okay. In the fusion reaction also, we are going to get this huge amount of energy after one fusion reaction. If after one fusion reaction we are going to get the 24 mega electron unit of energy, then inside the sun, we are having the same thermonuclear reaction, the nuclear fusion reaction. So that's why this much energy has been radiating out. 3.8 into 10 to the power 26 joules of energy is radiating outside, out from the sun in 1 second. Okay. So these three facts, based on these three facts, we can say that the thermonuclear reaction or the nuclear fusion reaction is the source of stellar energy. Is it clear? So, however, here inside the sun or inside the star, the nuclear fusion reaction takes place in two different cycles. In two different cycles. One is proton-proton cycle and another one is carbon and nitrogen cycle. Carbon nitrogen cycle. Two cycles we are having. One is proton cycle, and the second one is carbon nitrogen cycle. Carbon nitrogen cycle. Right? So in these two cycles, the fusion reaction is going to take place inside the sun or a star. Okay, as you are looking on the board, we have written the proton-proton cycle and here the carbon-nitrogen cycle. So let us study the proton-proton cycle here. So look here. Initially, we have seen which are the components have been used and which are the components have been left. Okay. So initially, the two hydrogen nuclei combined to form a deuterium hydrogen isotope, H2 isotope. Okay. 1H1 plus 1H1 gives 1H2 isotope. And after combining the two hydrogen nuclei, they will emit a positron. Look here. After emitting the positron, they will give deuterium nuclei, nucleus. Okay. That is the H2 isotope. And along with that, they are going to give the 0.4 mega electron volt of energy.
reaction with the, again the hydrogen atom, hydrogen nucleus, okay? This H2 nucleus is combining with the hydrogen nucleus and is going to give the helium-3 isotope, that is 2He3, with a release of 5.5 mega electron volt energy. Similar reaction, one more reaction takes place, okay? Here also, two hydrogen nucleus combined together, they are going to give a hydrogen-2 isotope, means a deuterium nucleus along with a positron and 0.4 electron volt of energy. Again, this deuterium is going to combine with the hydrogen and it is going to form the helium-3 isotope, that is 2H3. And again, it will release a 5.5 electron volt of energy. So, this is the type of reaction. We have to consider the two set of the similar reaction. Why? In the next step, we are having the combination of the 2He3 isotopes. Here we have got 1He3. Like that, from this reaction we have got 1He3. Okay? So this He3 and He3 isotopes combined here. 2He3 plus 2He3 combined together, then we are going to give the helium nucleus, 2H4, the helium nucleus. Along with this helium nucleus, we are going to get two hydrogen atoms emitted and 4.9 mega electron volt of energy. Is it clear? So look here, two hydrogens are used and deuterium emitted. Here also two hydrogens used, deuterium emitted, and this deuterium again used to combine with the hydrogen. And which is the unused part here? The positron, one positron left. Okay? And here again we have one positron, total two positrons emitted during the process. So again here, helium-3 isotope, helium-3 isotope. Those two are used to combine in order to give the helium-4. Okay? So here also the two hydrogen nucleus are being emitted. But those two were utilized in one more proton-proton cycle reaction. Again, these two will combine and they will give the deuterium. This process will continue. Okay? And during the whole process, how many hydrogens we have used? 1, 2 pair. That is a pair. 2 pairs of hydrogens we have used. Here 1 pair and here 2nd pair. And how many hydrogens we are having in that 2 pairs? 1, 2, 3, 4. So 4 hydrogen atoms we have used. And then from that 4 hydrogen atoms we have got the helium nucleus. Along with that, we have got the 2 positrons emitted and the energy 0.4 plus 5.5, 0.4 plus 5.5 plus 12.9 combined, we are going to get 24.7 mega electron volt of energy. This is the proton-proton cycle. Is it clear? Okay. Next, we have here the carbon hydrogen cycle. So carbon full isotope of the combining the hydrogen and it will form some nitrogen-13 isotope. 7 nitrogen-13, okay? Or nitrogen-13-7. So here it is a compound of a nucleus. So by emitting a positron, it will become the carbon-13-6. Okay? Again, here the carbon-13-6 combines with the hydrogen and it will give the nitrogen-7 and 13. The nitrogen 14 7 along with the energy. And again here the nitrogen 14 7 is going to combine with the hydrogen and it will give the oxygen 15A and it is the compound nucleus. By emitting the energy, sorry, by emitting the positron, it will become the nitrogen 15 7. Again, nitrogen 15 7 is combining with the hydrogen and it will give the carbon flow along with the helium nucleus along with the energy. Okay, along with the energy. As you can look here, the how many hydrogen atoms directly we have used? 1, 2, 3 and 4. Okay.
So 4 hydrogen atoms or a nucleus we have used here. Okay.
Hydrogen nucleus using those 4, what we have got?
We have got
the helium nucleus.
Along with helium nucleus, how many positrons we have got?
Here it is the 1 positron and here the 2 positrons.
Two positrons we have got along with energy.
Along with energy. Okay.
So finally, you can look here. Okay. So final reaction
here and here.
From both the proton-proton cycle and the carbon-hydrogen cycle, the final product is going to be same. And here, whatever extra hydrogens we have got, they will be utilized in the next proton-proton cycle. And here, whatever carbon four we have got, that will be used in the next carbon-hydrogen cycle. Okay. I take a screenshot of this one and I write it in your notes.